Like I said, today I'm going to talk about how we can build smarter solutions using Azure and Cognitive Services. So what we are going to see today is how we basically can use low-code, no-code solutions to actually implement Cognitive Services and bring those all those different things to our solutions just by connecting to them, configuring them, and using it that way. So quick introduction about myself. I'm Albert Groteboer. I come from Netherlands. I work in Rotterdam in a company called Motion 10. And so Motion 10 is basically focused on everything Microsoft. Myself, I'm mostly focused on Azure. I also do some Power Platform, but Motion 10 also focuses on things like data analytics, about things like modern workplace. And so we focus on everything Microsoft and mostly cloud, basically. I'm also an Azure MVP. So as Ivo already said, I like to work with the community. Speaking, blogging, writing books, whatever I can do. If I can share with the community, that's what I like to do. So yes, that's what I will be doing. If you have any questions, please let me know. You can always reach out to me on Twitter. So any questions, any remarks, and just let them come through. And with that, let's go have a look at Cognitive Services. And before we look at Cognitive Services, we first have to understand what is cognition. So cognition is the mental action or process requiring knowledge and understanding through thought, experience, and senses. So what does this say? This says that we understand what's happening around us, that we can interpret what's happening around us by looking at things, seeing things, hearing things, by then understanding what's happening. So if I get the text in front of me, I can read the text and understand what's happening in this text. Or if I hear some audio, I can listen to this, and then I understand what someone is trying to say to me or what might be playing back on a video. So that way I understand what's happening through those senses. So when we then go to Cognitive Services, so Cognitive Services are basically APIs that democratize that artificial intelligence by allowing systems to see, hear, speak, understand, interpret using those same natural methods of communication. So systems using vision, using audio, using text, understanding what's in there, and taking action from that. So that is what Cognitive Services are. They use those same senses, and we can then use those senses through APIs. So we have AI that are exposed to APIs, and we can send in, for example, a piece of text, and it'll come back with me saying, okay, you sent in this piece of text, and this is what I got from this. Let's have a look at the Azure Cognitive Services. So the Azure Cognitive Services are all about, of course, implementing those cognitive services on the Azure platform. And if we look at Azure Cognitive Services, we can distinguish in a couple of different ones. We are going to quickly show them, and then we will run through each of them in a bit more detail. First of all, we have decision making. So this is really about logical decision making, like if this, then do this, then do this. We have language, which is all about text. So I can understand, okay, what's happening in text. I can understand sentiments. Speech, which is all about spoken words. Vision is about what we see, about video, about images. And web search is about basically all those different Bing services that are out there. So let's have a quick look into each of these and just have a quick look at what is in each of these services. And the first one we're going to look at is the Decisions API. So Decision API has an anomaly detector in there. And this allows us to find outliers in our data. For example, if I have a stream of credit card transactions, with an anomaly detector, I can see, hey, all of a sudden I see some strange transaction there. If I'm normally only paying in Rotterdam, and all of a sudden I am paying something in New York, and an hour later I'm paying something in China, this service can help detect those outliers and can trigger a warning, say, hey, there's some outliers, and then I might block that credit card, for example. Next one would be content moderator. And this is about when I, for example, I'm hosting my own website and I allow people to upload pictures, I might want to remove some pictures if they are, for example, not suited for work, or if there's some other content in there like violence that I don't want on my website. I can teach a content moderator to detect those pictures and then remove those from my uploaded pictures, without me having to constantly look at this myself. And finally, Personalizer is about creating rich personalized experience for every user. And basically, this allows us, for example, like we see at Amazon or another different web shops, where when I buy something, it will give me back like, okay, if you bought this, then you might also be interested in this. And so the personalized service gets all the data and then correlates the data with those different articles, for example. So that is the decision API. Next up, we have the language API. And like I said, it's all about text. So first of all, we have the immersive reader, which helps readers with all abilities to comprehend text using audio and visual cues. So for example, if I draw a house, it will explain that this is a house. Or it can actually read the text by saying, okay, this is the text that's now being exposed. We have language understanding, which will actually help me to understand if I send some text in, what I'm trying to accomplish. So it's also called Lewis, which we'll see later on. And Lewis will basically help me if I send in text like, I want to order pizza. It will understand that, hey, your intent is to order pizza. So I might have to open up a webshop for pizza for you. More on this in a bit. We have the Q&A maker, which is a really easy way to get started with these services. With the Q&A maker, I just can pick up my whole Q&A text, push it in the Q&A maker, and it will create a button top of this. And I can start conversational questions, and it will come back with answers for me from this text, from my Q&A text. We have text analysis, which allows me to detect sentiment, key phrases, named entities. And so, for example, if I look on Twitter, I can get a stream of tweets in. And for example, if I'm working with the Xbox team, I can see, are people happy about the Xbox? Are they angry? What's going on? So that way I can understand, okay, what are people doing? What is this text like? Is this a text about, for example, history, or is this about something else? So I can actually understand what's happening in text. And finally, we have the translator. And translator kind of explains itself. We already saw it in the previous session as well. It allows you to translate text to all different kinds of languages. Then we have the speech API. And speech API, first of all, has speech to text. So I can talk to this API, I can send an audio fragment, and we'll come back with the written text for me. I can also do the other way around. So I can send some text, and we'll actually come back with an audio fragment for me. But what I'm really interested in myself is speech translation. What you can actually do is on-the-fly speech translation. And they already showed this a couple of years ago with Skype, where I can, so for example, speak in Dutch, and then Eve would get it in Danish. And we could just talk in our own languages, and this would on-the-fly translate our speech and give it to the other person in their native language, and they can speak in their native language, and I would hear it in Dutch again. And finally, speaker recognition allows me to identify and verify people based on their speech. So if they're speaking, I can understand, okay, who is speaking right now? And I can actually verify, okay, who is in this conversation. Then we have the vision API. And vision API is, for example, about computer vision, where I can upload some pictures and it will actually get me back the content. For example, if I upload a picture of the Eiffel Tower, it will come back to me like this is a historic point, it's Eiffel Tower. If I upload a picture from Bill Gates, it will come back to me like, this is Bill Gates, this is his age, this is his features. I have custom vision. So when I want something more than I can just do with normal computer vision, I can actually create my own models in a very easy way by just uploading a bunch of pictures, train it, and explain what each picture is. And it will then understand, okay, so next time I get a picture in, I can those know what to look for. You have the face API, which I can use to detect faces in a picture. I can identify those faces. So I can actually say, okay, this is the face from Ellen Grotebourg. I have the form recognizer, which allows me to extract text from key value pairs. So from table or document. And this works really well, for example, on receipts, so those kind of things where I really have key, like those key value pairs. We'll see this a bit more in just a minute. I have the ink recognizer, where I can actually just write and it will actually get my OCR on that handwriting. It also does not only handwriting, but also like if I draw a shape, it will actually understand if I draw a shape of like a house, it will understand, okay, this is a house, and it will actually make this come back to me like, okay, this is what you have drawn. And finally, the video indexer allows me to analyze visual and audio channels of a video and actually indexes content. So it'll tell me, okay, there was movement on this part. It will get me back a transcription of what was being said. It will get me the text that was being told. It will get like, if there's once again Eiffel Tower in there, it will come back to me. So actually analyze this and index all that content. And finally, we have web search. And web search is about all those different Bing services, which I'm not going to run all of them because I think everyone will know them. But for example, for my own applications, I can integrate this and start doing image search. I can do video search. I can do auto suggest. And this is all done just by integrating with those APIs, and I can just bring this all into my own applications. So why should we use Azure Cognitive Services? First of all, it's very easy to integrate. It's all serverless. I actually pay for what I use. I don't have to run services for this or anything like that. It's just APIs I can add and can use them. And it's very easy to integrate into my own services. They're very flexible, so they have SDKs, of course, but it's also just a REST API. So if I can just call out a REST API, then I can just use this. And it's tried and tested. So this is being used by Microsoft products all the time. For example, all those text services that you saw, this is being built into Word. Those Bing services we are using every day when we use Bing to search something. The video analyzer is used by Microsoft itself as well. Like, this is being used in their own products. And we can now use those same APIs to use this in our services. I want to make a quick step because we are going to talk about bots now. And though bots are not directly Cognitive Services, they are often used together with Cognitive Services. And so today I will be using a bot, which will be integrated with Lewis. And so I want to quickly talk about bots because bots allow me to actually create those conversational styles where I can talk to a bot, it can come back to me, and I can use those APIs from Cognitive Services to do a lot of these things. So when we create our own bots, we have a couple of different options. So first of all, we have the Power Virtual Agents. Part of the Power Platform and really easy to get started with is just drag and drop. I just configure it, create my dialogue, I create some decisions in there. And like I said, it's all drag and drop, so really easy to set up. Now, because it's so easy to set up and because it's all just drag and drop, it also means you don't have that much control. Like, I can just drag and drop some stuff. I cannot, for example, change any dialogues, like saying, okay, now I want date picker or something like that. You also have the AdBot, and AdBot has a bit more control. You can use it together with Power Automate or with Logic Apps, and it allows me to actually call out to an external service. It's not a third-party service, not Microsoft, it's third-party service, but I have been using it a lot because you get a bit more control. You can much more easily integrate with some different other services, because it's, for example, we're using the Logic Apps, while still just being like low-code configuration. The one I'm going to show you today is Azure Bot Service, and this is actually a pro code or a full code solution where I can create my own bot all in C# code. And because of this, it's very versatile. I can just do anything that I want. And that's the one we are going to use today together with Lewis. And so Azure Bot Service, you can create bots like this where it's very stylized. I can create my own screens. I can create my own dialogues. So it's very powerful. It's very extendable because it's all just C# code. And I can just actually create my own dialogues and code and stuff like that. It integrates with Cognitive Services out of the box. It already integrates with Lewis for language understanding and integrates with the translator as well. And I can hook this into multiple channels. I can hook this into Teams, into Slack, on my website, wherever I want. And with that, let's actually go to a demo, because I think Cognitive Services are best explained through demos. And so the scenario I want to show you today is my scenario about how I work with ships. So I told you I'm working with Motion 10, that's my full-time job. But next to Motion 10, I also have my own company. So in my own company, it's like a side job. And in this my company, I basically go to ships, like these kind of ships, and I install computers, hardware, software, those kind of things. Now, this is a ship, for example, a ship my brother and my dad work on, so I have to visit them regularly. And these ships come to these refineries here. So think Shell, think Esso, think BP, name all the big ones. I live in Rotterdam, so of course we have a lot of them over here. So when I go to one of these refineries, what I have to do is I have to call to the ship, or they call me, saying, okay, so I could come to the ship because I have to replace a computer. Then they have to call to the refinery. They have to tell, okay, Altgrootboer is coming. He's coming in the car with this license plate. Here, they provide a lot of information about me, about, okay, what is he going to do? How is he coming? Stuff like that. I then have to go actually go to the ship. I have to go register myself with them. Half of the time, not all the information is there, so it's kind of annoying sometimes. So I was thinking, how can we make this easier? And that's my demo that I want to do today, because that registration I'm just talking about, like they have to call to the refinery might call me. There's a lot of conversations going on about different information they need. So how can we make this easier? And I'm thinking, let's do this through actually creating a bot for this. So I can create a bot. I could create a bot that's going to email, but what I'm going to create is actually a chatbot. And this bot I created, and let me actually switch over here. So I created this bot over here, and this bot, and what you will see is, this is the emulator. I could, of course, integrate this into Teams or somewhere else, but in this case, I'm just using emulator. When I open this bot, it will tell me, okay, welcome to the Rotten Terminal. How can I help you today? So let's start registering myself. First of all, I want to register a visitor. So I can now start a dialogue. So I can talk to the bot like, okay, I want to register a visitor. It's coming back. Which ship would you is going to be visited? Let's say that I'm going to visit that sometimes LNG that we just saw. It's come back with its name. So that would be me, Elliot Groteboer. When would the visit take place? Well, let's say it's going to be tomorrow. There was a reason. I need to do some computer repairs. As you can see, I can just have this dialogue and ask all the questions. So I actually know that I will have all the information in the end. Because this bot knows, just goes through the script like, okay, these are all the, this is all the information I need. On which email address? So okay, let's give my email address. There we go. And I can now just, it's now come back to me, okay, so Elder Code is going to visit this ship tomorrow for computer repairs. Is this correct? And I can now say yes or no. In this case, yes, it's correct. It is now going to actually call out to my backend APIs. So my bot is now calling out to Logicap. And Logicap is going to actually check my registration. And it sees that, okay, it has been registered now. It asks me, do you want to upload a picture? And this we are going to use later on, because with the picture, I'm actually going to use the Face API later on to recognize that I'm the person that has been registered. So I actually do want to upload a picture. So let's do this. I'm going to upload a picture of myself. There you go. So it's now going to register this picture. It's going to register it with the Face API. It's going to train the model saying, okay, this is Elder Code Bull. He's coming in tomorrow. And as my registration has now been processed. Okay, so quick show of the code. Like I'm not going to run through the code. This is not a session about the bot framework. Just very quickly to show you like, what does this kind of dialogue look like? So as you can see, I've got a couple of different steps. So I have these steps over here. So I have a ship step, a name step, a visit date time step. And it's just going to run through all of these steps. And these steps are going to say, okay, these are the questions basically that I'm getting. And so for example, the ship step is actually going to say, okay, which ship would you like to visit? And as you can see, it will get the details from this and will then save this and go to the next step. Next step will be my name. So the name of the visitor. And it's just going to run through all these steps. And at the end, it's going to call out to my, and in the end, it's going to call out to my, actually, let me show you. So it's going to call out to my Logicap. It's, I don't know where in the, which adapter it is over here. So let me actually just go over here. So it's going to call out to my Logicap. And if I go over here. So first of all, I want to show you. So I just actually did like this. I said over here, I want to register a visitor. So I could also have something to set something else. Like I could have said, can I register a visitor? So I can now use different text and will still understand like, okay, you want to visit the ship, what's your ship? Like it still starts the same dialogue. Now, of course, I could just try and figure out every possible way that this can get started and hard to code that into my application. Probably not what I want to do. So instead, I'm using Lewis language understanding, which is integrated with the bot framework. And in Lewis, I can create an intent. And an intent is, in this case, my register visitor intent. And if I open this, there are some different utterances, as they call it. And so as you can see, I have these different phrases, basically, which I use to say, OK, if you get these kind of text, then you have to start this intent of a register repair. So, and as you can see, I have some different things in here. Like I have these entities, like L Grote would be person name, sometimes LNG would be the ship. But I can actually also like already give some answers in front and it will actually skip those questions. So if I would say I need to do repairs on the Sontos LNG, it will actually skip the question of what is ship you're going to visit, because actually it is going to get this out of my utterance already. So it's going to use this to actually start my conversation and then just going to look to all those different questions. Now, when this was done, all the questions were done, it said, okay, I'm not going to register. And that is when that logic app is getting started. So if I refresh this, I will see that indeed it just ran. And let me open this just to show what is done. And you might see I already got the new logic app experience. So this is now rolling out on different environments. So I got now this new nice logic app experience with the new code designer for those that know it from before. But basically what this does, my bot just calls out an HP endpoint. It's going to call out the Dataverse. And as you can see, it's all low code, like it's very easy to set up and everyone can very easily set this up. I call out to my CRM4 Dataverse and it's going to check, okay, do we already have a registration for the Sontos LNG in our system? Because if there's no registration in their system, that means that the ship is actually not registered with this Rotterdam tank terminals. And they will just come back saying, hey, sorry, the ship, we don't know the ship, you cannot register here. Now, in this case, it was true, so I would go in here. It would then get a visitor, so it would also check my same Dataverse, like, do we already know El Troteboer? If not, I need some validation, because then actually they're going to call out to the ship. We'll send an email to the ship saying, okay, we have someone that wants to come visit you. It's El Troteboer, here's some information that we got from him. Do you know this person? And this is just an email they will get on the ship. If they say, yes, we know this person, then it will actually create a visitor in my Dataverse. Otherwise, it would terminate. Now, in this case, I was already registered because I've done this demo before. So I was already was registered, so it did find me. And then it just updates me saying, okay, we have a new registration for this specific visitor. And finally, it creates an event, and this event just gets sent out to all the different parties saying, okay, so you are expected to be there tomorrow for the Sontos LNG for computer repairs. So I can now accept this. It would be in my calendar. The same goes out to the ship and the same goes out actually to the tank terminal itself. So everyone now knows, okay, El Troteboer is going to come in. So that is the first part. That's actually registration of that visitor. The second part is that with a picture that I uploaded. And that's where it gets more interesting, because now we are actually going to use those cognitive services. So what I did, I uploaded the picture. So basically I just uploaded a picture to Blob Storage. The picture that I showed you, I uploaded to Blob Storage. And when this was uploaded to Blob Storage, I use Event Grid to trigger whenever a new picture is uploaded. So as you can see here, I have a blob created event. So whenever I upload the blob, it will start this flow. I start setting some variables, and then we get a visitor. So because I first registered, it knows, okay, the visitor is there. It will actually check this, because if it was not registered yet, it would have a delay, like it would wait for a day for me actually to get back, like if the registration comes through. And then in some case, at some point, the register is found, the visitor is found, so it continues. And then we go over here. So we update our Face API. So what we are going to do is we are going to check if our CRM system already has a Face API person ID. So if it does, then we are going to, actually if it doesn't, then we are going to create a person, we are going to update it. In this case, I already had this because I already was registered before. So in this case, I already had my Face API. So what I'm going to do then is I'm going to grab the link to that blob that I created, so that picture that I uploaded. I'm going to add a person face. So I'm going to get that Face API person ID. I'm going to get my web URL. So I'm going to add the picture of myself. I'm going to add it to my person. So the person is El Troteboer. So the Face API knows El Troteboer. If it didn't, we would have created that person over here. And at that point, we can now upload the picture saying, okay, so this picture, this is El Troteboer. So I add that image, I add it to my person. And I then train this. So I now update my model saying, okay, I have a new picture for you. So this is El Troteboer. I can use more pictures for a bit more better results. In this case, I'm just using one picture. So I just have like an okay result probably. Like it will probably be like 50, 60% sure that this is me. If I upload like 10 pictures, it will be like 99% sure it will be me. And finally, I delete the blob because I'm done with this blob, so I can now go ahead. So by now we have actually, created our registration. We have our registration in our Dataverse. We have our, everyone knows about this. And we have also uploaded that picture of myself saying, okay, if you see this person, this will be El Troteboer, so they have actually been registered. So I can now, tomorrow, I would drive over there. I would go to the tank terminal and then you come to something like this. So normally I would now have to get out of the car. I would walk to this little office over here. I would register myself like saying, hey, I'm El Troteboer. I come from this and this ship. They will look up in the computer. Wouldn't it be easier though if I could just drive up to this gate, look at the camera, and just they know, okay, this is El Troteboer, because they already have my picture there. So they know, yes, this is El Troteboer. They can look up my person, like, and they can then just see, okay, has he been registered? So that's what we are going to implement next. So let's go back over here. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to upload my picture. And this will be a different picture than I used, of course, than when I registered myself. So let's use this one. As you can see, it's a different picture. I can upload this. And once when I upload this, it will once again trigger that that logic app using the same scenario, so as you can see, I just run. So let's go and see what happens here. So once again, we use the same mechanism. So when a research event occurs, when a blob has been uploaded, set some variables, it gets that path to the blob. So it gets a path with the SAS URI, so I can actually use this with my face API. And then I'm going to call out to this face API and say detect faces. And this is going to come back with me, okay, I think I know this person because they are from this picture, and I think it will probably be El Troteboer. So I first detect, I first detected there's a face in the picture. So it first detects a face. It then comes back to me like, yes, I have found the face. This is the face ID. And then use that face to identify this. And what I want to show you here is like, here you can see I'm using the out-of-the-box connector for Face API. The small issue with logic apps is not all those APIs, not all those connectors are constantly updated. So detect faces still works, but identify actually doesn't work with built-in connector from logic apps. So what I did instead, I'm exposing the same API through API management. So I have my face API over here, and I'm just exposing this face API. So what you'll see if I go to my settings, is I'm just exposing this API for my content service for my face API. And I can then use this to do this identify. There we go. And if I go over to my, over here, actually no, not this one, over here. As you'll see, I actually could just call out to this endpoint and will just say, okay, what does this look like? I get some definitions back. I can show you like I have some requests, I think. Yeah, there we go. So I have a sample request that I'm expecting. I can use this now for my logic app. So for my logic app, I'm using my API management connector to call out this identify API within my face API. It's going to first, it got the face out of the picture. It's then going to identify the face. And then it comes back like, do I know this person? And so in this picture, do I know this person? So if I do, I get the visitor details. And then finally, I send a message to a search bus. And now actually, let's have a look at the result of that call. What I can now do, like as you can see, all those steps were okay. And I want to have this step over here because I want the result of my what I got back here. So let me put this into over here. Use this one so I can actually have some. There we go. So as you can see, it came back with me like, yes, this face ID. So from the detect faces is this person. And this person, I can check in Dataverse, this is El Troteboer. And I knows this by about 54% sure. So it's about 54% sure that, yes, this is El Troteboer. So because I now know this, like, okay, so this is probably El Troteboer. What I will now do is I send this message to my service bus. And that person that's in that boot will now get this on his screen. So I have like an operator there that will operate like the boom of the where I have to go to. It will operate the gate and will now see, yes, so this is El Troteboer. He can see my picture. He can probably have a camera next to it. So he can also like do a quick comparison himself. Like, yes, it's actually this person. They see that, yes, my security calls are done because I actually got that information from my dataverse. And it checks, okay, so you have a visit on Sonus LNG on this date. So he can now see, okay, so Al Troteboer actually has a registration and we are expecting him for this Sonus LNG. So they will now know, okay, so he actually has been registered and he can actually come in. Now, before I can proceed though, I also have to check my vehicle because, for example, I want to check my technical status. Like, is this car actually allowed to drive on the road? So has it or at this period of maintenance, maybe some other checks I want to do. And another important one is my fuel type. And so explain this, there's different refineries that allow different fuel types of fuel to drive on the terrain. So for example, the O-tanking doesn't allow you to go on their refinery if you are driving a petrol car, where I think it was BP that doesn't allow you to drive there with an electric vehicle. So there's different refineries that don't allow you to come on their onto the refinery with different types of cars. So they also have to check, okay, the car you're driving with, are you actually allowed to drive this car on the refinery? So now let's have a look at that as well. So what I'm going to do is I have my car camera over here. So once again, this will be another camera at the gate. So one camera will be at my face, the other will be at my license plate. So if I now upload the picture of my license plate, actually over here. And let me just show you quickly that this indeed does have my license plate in here. So this is the picture we're going to upload. So if I upload this picture, there we go. Once again, a same ID. Let me just check if that's is running. So in between, let me just show you once again what we're doing. So once again, same mechanism. I upload the blob. It will get some information about this. It gets the path. And then we're going to use another concrete service. So now we are going to use the OCR service. And this OCR service will get all the text from my picture. I'm then going to use a function because there might be some different text in there. So I already know, like on my license plate, there's text NL for Netherlands. There's my license plate in there itself. There might be some more text on that. For example, if I have a company card, there might be some text from the company name. So I'm going to use a function. And in this function, it's a very simple function. It's just going to check, okay, I'm going to push in all the information from that I got back from that OCR, so all those different texts. I'm just going to loop to all of them and I'm just going to check, okay, give me all the ones where I have text that's 8 characters long, because our Dutch license plate numbers are 8 characters long. And has at least 2 dashes in there, exactly 2 dashes in there. Because all license plates have 2 dashes in there. So very easy way to recognize a license plate number. I'm not sure if this would be something that you would in production, but for this demo, definitely. And it is a very easy way actually to recognize those license plate numbers. So once it finds this, it will get the first one and will give me that back without the dashes. So it actually removed dashes because next API I'm going to call doesn't want the dashes in there. So as we do this, it's then going to get a call out another API. So in this case, I'm going to call out to the RDW, as we call it. It's the Dutch. So the RDW is the Dutch agency that has all the information about all the cars that are registered in the Netherlands. And I'm going to call 2 calls to them. The first one will give me back some information about my last period of maintenance and things like that. And the second one will give me back my fuel information, like what type of fuel I'm driving on. Now, this, of course, will be coming back in Dutch. So what now we're also going to do is call another concrete service to actually do a translation. So we are going to call the over here the translator API. So once again, this is concrete service. As you can see, it's concrete service, the Microsoft translator. And this is a very easy one to use because what I push in this text. So I'm going to get the text and this text will be my fuel type. So this might be something like benzine, which means petrol. And will give me back my English version of this because I'm going from Dutch to English. And then we're going to send another message to my operator. So a few things to show you, just to show what responses we got. So first of all, the OCR stuff. So here, show you what's in here. As you can see, I got some different things back. Like I got this, I don't know where this is coming from. It might be from the VW logo or something like that. Here I got my license plate number itself. This is actually what I'm looking for. And also this NL box, which is also on the license plate, like saying this is the license plate from Netherlands. So this is the thing I sent into that function, and then the function comes back with this data over here. So if I go over here to my function plate, function recognizer, I will get back this PG811G. And this is actually what I wanted. So my license plate without any dashes. That's what I'm going to send into my RDW API. So I'm going to send in, please give me the information about this license plate number. And then I get back all this information about my car. As you can see, I drive Volkswagen Golf. And the date of my APK, as we call it, so my periodic maintenance, is in July. So for now, it's still okay because I only need to do my check in July and I will have it done before then. So they know, okay, it has some periodic check, so that's fine. It also got that fuel information back. And like I said, it's actually in Dutch. So what you'll see here is that it says benzine. Now, like I said, I want my operator to see this in English instead. So what we are going to do next is call out this translate fuel type. And over here, I got this response here saying, okay, this is petrol. And so I'm actually now going to send this petrol back to my operator. And if we go over here, you'll see that indeed my license plate number is there. He sees the picture. He sees that it's a petrol car. He sees that my periodic maintenance was done. And he can now open the gate to actually let me in. So he's now going to open the gate. I'm driving in. I'm going to the ship. I do my work. And then I will just drive back out. And when I drive back out, I have to ask for some signatures with the ship. So I have to sign a worksheet. And on this worksheet, I have to, of course, write out like what did I do on the ship. And I also have to have an approval on there. So I have to have a signature on there. So let me quickly show you this as well. So we are going to upload another one. And in this case, I'm going to upload a picture of one of those worksheets. So let me show you over here. So I'm going to upload this demo.jpg. As you can see, so I'm visiting the Santos LNG. I did computer repairs. It was signed on this date by this person. And as you already can see, like my handwriting is not that great. Like my handwriting is definitely not amazing. But if I now upload this, let me throw this one away first. And let me try it again. Okay, there we go. Upload. So now upload it. And this is going to trigger, of course, another logic app. So this is going to trigger another logic app over here. So it's now running. And while this is running, let me quickly show you the form recognizer testing tool. So what you can do in this tool, it's just a public website that you can use for this. You connect to your own form recognizer, because that's the API we are going to use now, another so-called service called form recognizer. And what you do here, you upload several pictures, and then you say on this picture, I'm interested, for example, in this Somtrans 6. I'm going to say this is the ship name. I'm going to say the reason is this deliveries. I'm going to say the sign by, the signee is this person. The date is over here. The signature is over here. And I did this, as you can see, for several different pictures with different text. Not for the demo, though. As you can see, the demo doesn't have like this trained model next to it. So it doesn't know about this demo, but it doesn't know about some other ones. And because I trained this, it will actually come back with me with the text. So it's finished. And so let's run through this. So once again, the same ID, like we are going to get some information about the upload blob. It's going to retrieve my latest model, because every time I train my model new, it's actually creating a new model number. So I want to use the latest one. And then it's going to call out to this analyze with custom form. Once again, this is a concrete service that I'm exposing to API management. It's a form recognizer over here. So it's form recognizer that I'm using for this. And as you will see, it will come back to me with some information about, okay, what was actually so it comes back to me like, okay, we submitted this and this is your action tracking ID. Now this is going to run in the background. So I actually have to wait for this to actually finish. As you can see, it did two runs. So I got my first result back. The first result would have said something like not started. I might get some back like running. And at some point I get back on the second one, I get a succeeded back. And let me check. So over here, there you go. So I got back this succeeded. Let me just show you what's coming back in here. What's in here, I got a succeeded back. It gives me some information about, okay, which different fields did we find. And this is actually what I'm interested in. So I see that I have a field called ship. And my ship, in this case, Somtrans LNG. Well, Ling, close enough. I got my date back. I got my signee back. I got this computer repairs back, like the text that was actually very hard to read. It actually understood that this said with computer repairs. So that's actually just quite a nice bit of OCR in that as well. And it found my signature. So it found this, it got like information back, and it once again sent a message to my operator. And my operator once again got this, it got this over here. So it says, okay, the ship that was visited, what did we do there? So it got all the information from here, and he sees, yes, a signature was found, so this is okay. So we have now seen how I can register myself to a bot using Lewis, so I can actually talk in natural language. I upload my picture to actually be recognized, and then when I got to the gate, it used that picture to actually recognize my face, like, okay, this is Oud Groteboer. It used a recognition on my license plate to actually do OCR on my license plate. It got back the information from the API, it translated this. And finally, once I finished on the ship, I had that worksheet. And the worksheet was also recognized by the form recognizer with all those text in there. So we have now seen how we can use those common sources in our real life scenario. Actually make a much smarter solution by just using the information we already can very easily get and use this to actually enhance our process. So a couple of takeaways from my session. So first of all, common source makes it very easy, very low entry to do complex work. It's just an API that you call. You don't have to know how do I actually recognize the license plate number, for example. How do I program OCR? How do I program detection of a face, for example? Anyone that has done some programming around vision knows this is a very hard problem to solve. And by just using these common sources, it makes it so much easier. It's also quite extensive. Microsoft keeps adding options on this. They keep coming out new content services. They keep improving them. They keep adding new options. So it just keeps expanding. And finally, it's very easy to integrate this. So I can actually use content services in any process. For example, I'm using Logicaps in this case. You could also use this in other processes, of course. But just by using this in your own processes, it's very easy to actually extend them and make them smarter. So think about your own processes, think about where you can use this, and start using these cognitive services. They are really easy to get started with, they're cheap to get started with, and it's really easy to implement them, because just like I showed you, you just, for example, send a URL to an image, and it'll come back with all the information about this without you having to know how to do all this stuff. So with that, I would like to say thank you. I hope you enjoyed the session. If you have any questions, please put them into the chat. If you have questions later on, if you watch a recording or something like that, you can always contact me. Thank you for being here, and thank you for having me on this great event today.